Special programs on BCTV are supported by the following. Keystone Property and Asset Management provides expert care of industrial, office, retail, and medical sites. With more than 4 million square feet managed, Keystone knows how to save you money.
Good evening. Welcome to Diversity of Wire Division. I'm Joseph Amprey. And I feel funny saying good evening because I'm taping this at 3 p.m. on Friday the 9th. You're watching me on Monday the 12th, so good evening. Tonight's program is a very important program. And I'll begin by telling you that it's done in October because there are several very important days that are commemorated in October. On the 11th, which was yesterday, it was National Coming Out Day. That's a day for people who have tried to hide their identities and for some reason, they haven't been able to be who they are. They've come out. I hope you can see me because I don't think I'm on the air. Are we okay, Jordan? I'll keep talking anyway. The 14th, are we on the air, Jordan? Okay, because I don't see me, but that's fine. I don't need to see me anyway. On the 14th is Natural Stop Bullying Day. Many, many gay and transgender people are bullied. And so we want to stop bullying, period. And that's a very important day. And the 19th is National GLBT Day, which stands for gay, lesbian, and days that we recognize people who are what we call sexual minorities. I have three fantastic guests who are here tonight. And before I introduce them, I want to tell you that as a psychologist, I can tell you that since 1973, the American Psychological Association, the National Association for Professional Psychologists, has said that it's okay to be gay. If you're gay or transgender, there's nothing wrong with you, you're healthy. The same thing was done the same year by the American Psychiatric Association, the organization that deals with mental health by physicians, and they said it's okay to be gay. So having said that, I want to introduce you to three people, three successful professionals who deal with this subject every day. And I guess I'll begin with the lady who I know is never shy, Dr. Deb Sieger. I'll tell you that she's a former president of the National Organization of Women for Pennsylvania. She's a longtime colleague of mine at Kutztown University, where she was a professor of both social work and criminal justice, and just a champion for all people who've been oppressed. Deborah, thank you for coming, Dr. Sieger. You are a godsend for our community, and thank you for taking time out of what should be retirement and laid back time for you to come on and talk about perhaps your experiences and your views about what we can do to make the world better for gay and transgender people.
I'm honored to be on. Thank you very much. There would have been a time when we wouldn't have given a thought to these particular dates in October, and they've got four of them, not just one. I guess to sum up what my experience has been is that if we just keep being who we are and get to know people and trust them a little, they begin to trust us, and that goes a long way. That doesn't work in all times and all experiences. There's no doubt about it. When we talk about diversity, I happen to have a strong bias towards the positiveness of the word. I was fortunate to have a faculty that was very diverse. And I was sitting at a meeting one day, and there were about four points of view on the table in front of me. I don't even remember the topic. And these people came at it with in the most constructive suggestions. And one was from Africa. His father was what would be a senator. Grew up in a home that had a dirt floor. Looks about as regal as any king I've ever seen in any movie. Is married to a certified registered nurse practitioner, a brilliant server of people in our community in Reading. And another guy from Ethiopia, and another guy from the Netherlands, and another guy from Philadelphia. And they gave us gender, race, degree, experience, and put all of that on the table. They couldn't have been any more different. And all of a sudden, we had five points of view to consider because those four were on the table and they were discussing the one that was already there. So there were five things. And I began to really, in my soul, feel the value of diversity. And that was a singular moment for me. I was a pretty old person by then, Joe. I bet you I was in my 50s when I had that aha.
You've always been young at heart.
I always agreed with diversity. I understood the whole idea of a salad as opposed to a melting pot of people. So you could tell the radishes from the onions and that was okay. You put them all in the salad and that was a much better way to go about it than mashing them all into some slippery soup that you're supposed to eat instead of a salad. And but it came upon me that the value of those differences of life experiences, difference didn't mean bad at all. Now, what we were confronted with was not the problem that had been put on the table by me because I was chairing the agenda. We now had five options. We didn't have five problems. We didn't even have one problem. We had the value of five points of view to choose from. And it was almost overwhelming. And I know that's too darn simplistic, especially we were talking about how hard it is for kids who are in the closet, young people who don't have jobs with incomes, who don't have parents. I know there are six people a semester that live in their cars at Kutztown University because their parents kicked them out of their homes. You don't go to somebody like that and say, you got to help me solve the problems of hatred of sexual minorities. They don't have the resources. They don't have the personal stamina. They don't have food sometimes. And so I'm not suggesting that, you know, the answer is rise to the occasion. What I'm saying is that my experience has been both as a woman and as an out lesbian woman, that if I just keep working hard, do the very best I can, respect all other people, even when I don't appreciate their point of view, and there's somebody in my life that I would hope to get rid of shortly. That you don't go around shooting people. And I think those of us who have been blessed with the ability to move other people to action are the ones, and some few of us are here, but in this society, those who have come before us have really opened some doors that when I was, you know, Carolyn's age, I would have never expected the kind of support. And yet there's a lot to do. I was thinking that just recently, God rest her soul, RBG and that Supreme Court decision. I was on my way home from our attorney. I had to change all my papers. They weren't up to date. And I was listening to the radio and I was on Lancaster Avenue coming home, you know, getting on the bypass to come out to my lovely, lovely home. And they announced it on the radio that the Supreme Court just said we could get married. It was like legal. I had to get off the road. I literally had to I pulled into McDonald's or the diner right before I got on the bike. I had to sit there. I couldn't control the car. I couldn't control my emotion. I thought, this is a landmark. And then I sank into the seat and I thought, God, I hope all of us don't think that because we can get married on Saturday, that we aren't going to lose our job on Monday, because marriage doesn't protect employment. And we still don't have employment protection for lesbians, gays, bisexual, transgender, and who knows how many other kinds of sexuality we could name. And so, there have been some giant steps to let people love each other. Imagine that, to encode in our law that people are allowed to choose whom they love. We're not so lucky about learning who to hate. We don't want that, but we sure don't have too much love in this world. So, you know, that's why I'm so delighted to see Carolyn on this. You know, I love the way kids who are out and strong about it are in our faces saying, last year, not quite this time, we took our eldest daughter to several colleges. She was picking where she wanted to go to school. And the first thing the admissions people got up and said is, I'm so-and-so and so-and-so, and the pronoun I use is X. And it's like, and then the second person did it. And then the third person did it. And it didn't matter whether it was the University of Pennsylvania, whether it was Boston University, whether it was the University of Pittsburgh, or, you know, they got up and they were quite clear about the pronoun they wanted to use. And the only problem I have with they, for people who want to say that they're they or them because they don't want to be on a binary system, is it's really hard to write a grammatical English sentence. And I'm an old fogey about grammar. I'm a card-carrying grammar police person. And I got to tell you, it's really difficult for me to say, wait a minute, that's the wrong pronoun. Well, is that wrong? It's wrong for my grammar rule. It's not wrong for the person who's stating it. And that's, you know, that's a really freeing thing, Joe. I mean, to come to that from being in the closet myself, not until I was in my mid-20s did I ever think that I would call myself a lesbian and be okay with that. And it took a long time. And thank God for the people whose shoulders I stand on who came before me. And the Ruth Bader Ginsburgs, who's as heterosexual as any woman could be, and an out supporter of rights of people. And oh my God, I wish we had cloned her 10 times before she died. So I'm a lucky woman. I do go back to saying, those of us who are out, we have some responsibility to behave responsibly in an adult manner, in a non-hateful way as best we can. As beacons of light for the kids who are so far in the back of the closet they couldn't find the door if they tried. So there are some real dichotomies in these wonderful, joyful dates that I wrote down, so I was sure not to forget them. And how long has it been, Michelle, since, you know, I don't know what page y'all were on in the newspaper, but I cut it out. LGB Center expanding programs and services while everything else is shutting down. Those queers, man, they're rearing their heads. And it's like, you don't think a virus is going to stop us, do you?
No way.
Worse than that. So I guess I'm in a good place. I'm a very fortunate out lesbian, let me tell you that. And I do admit to working hard for what I became. I was fortunately a second generation college graduate. Both my grandparents graduated from Kutztown, grandparents graduated from Kutztown University. So I come from actually a second generation of college graduates, and I know how blessed I was to have had that experience and those people in my family who also became educators and value education. So I'm going to shut up because I want to hear from some other folks, and you can get back to me later. Thanks.
Well, Deb, thank you so much for all you've done for so many people. God bless you, and thanks for being here. You are a godsend for a world which is so narrow, but people like you help us make it better.
Thanks, Joe.
And I'm sure Caroline Cook is happy that you think she's a youngster, but she looks very young. I had the pleasure of meeting her early this summer. She was on a course with me. She's a former professional at Muhlenberg College, where she worked in the theater department. She's now in a whole different field in Virginia. She can tell you about that. But she's also an athlete and proud of who she is and what she does. And Caroline, thank you for taking the time to come on today. I don't know what your schedule's like, but you also are a positive person who can really be a role model for their somebody watching who probably is afraid to come out, who needs some support. And just your presence makes a big difference. And thank you so much for being available today.
Well, I'm so.
What your thoughts are about the subject, and tell me your experiences, please.
Well, I'm so excited to be here, and I'm so happy to be amongst so many amazing people who are speaking out and who are out and proud in their communities. When I first came out, I was 20 years old. I was a sophomore. Between my freshman and sophomore year of college. I had been kind of experiencing my sexuality a little bit before I finally named it. And when I did, I had always had parents who told me it didn't matter. It didn't matter. Well, it didn't matter until it mattered. I have an uncle, my mother's brother, who is 5 years older than her, who had been out for a long time. And when I came out to my mother, she had a really hard time with it. And she said it was out of a fear for the life that she thought I would have. Yeah. And she at one point said to me, she, no, I'm not mad at you. I'm just mourning the loss of the daughter I thought I had. Well, to me, I hadn't changed. I was just learning new things about myself. And that was really hard for me because my mother and I had always been very close. Now, I will say since then, I allowed my mother the time to appreciate my new confidence, appreciate who I was becoming. And since that time, our relationship has grown incredibly close again. And she's incredibly supportive. She loves my wife. So that was an interesting experience for me because growing up, you know, I had queer people who are in my family, not an overabundance of them, but I had queer family members and I had always been told it didn't matter. And so it was a real shock to me when it did. But since then, you know, our family, everyone loves my wife because she's incredibly intelligent and a wonderful human being and treats me the way that I deserve. You know, I would say on the subject of coming out happens every day. I find particularly now that I've left the university setting, it happens even more often. You know, working in a university, working at a college, typically, not everywhere, but many universities are very liberal, accepting, wonderful places where they do introduce themselves with their pronouns. You know, my name is Caroline, I use she, her. And when you step out of that and you move into communities that are perhaps less accepting, it can be kind of tricky to navigate and you have to worry about your safety and you have to be careful. And for me, moving from Pennsylvania in the 2-hour distance from New York City to rural Virginia, when I was taking job interviews, when I was looking at places I wanted to be, I did think about those things. And I did think like, is this a place I can be myself and be safe? Because I've also reached a point in my life where I'm so happy with who I am and how I move through the world and the person I'm married to that I don't want to be dishonest. I don't want to feel like I have to hide who I am. So I was very cautious when taking job interviews and feeling out the companies that I could be myself. And I found a wonderful company that I work for in rural Virginia. You know, politically it leans very conservative. And so a lot of the times I didn't lead with, hey, my name's Caroline, I'm a big lesbian. You know, I allowed my work to speak for itself. I allowed my kind nature to speak for itself. And when people asked me about my personal life, I said, I'm married to a wonderful woman. Her name's Deb. And it was because people got to know me first as a person, as a hard worker, as someone they could trust, that by the time we got down the road to, and I'm this thing, it wasn't a big deal anymore because I'd already proved to myself that I'm not just, to them and myself, that I'm not just that thing. I think that as members of what I've heard called a silent minority, you don't always know you're one of us until you know you're one of us. You know, it's not always written on our faces or in how we walk through the world. You know, it can be hard to not always lead with that one thing. But we as a community are so rich and so diverse. And I feel blessed to have had the experiences that I have and to have found a place to work, even in a conservative area of a formerly conservative state. We're turning a little more blue. You know, to found a place that I can be myself, even in spite of some of the conservative people around me, and to find that, like, by being patient and being kind and being myself, I'm also in some ways changing hearts and minds that way too, because people tend to accept us more when they love us more. And that's kind of my experience. As you also said, I play roller derby, so that's my big outlet. Of course, we're not playing right now with the pandemic, but that has also been a place where I've found my people and where I've found the people who would you know, literally bare arms for me, literally would have put their bodies next to mine in a battle of skill, and people who would protect me and who would march for me and fight for me if it ever came down to it. And I think that's also important. And sometimes we're not, sometimes being part of a gender and sexual minority, sometimes you don't find your family with your family, but your family's out there. And that's been really important to me, especially when I wasn't feeling as accepted by my family as I am now. To find the people who loved me no matter what, loved me for who I am, specifically those parts of who I am that I couldn't share with my family. It's been really important. And it's been an important addition to my life and an enrichment of my life.
Thank you so much, Caroline. I'll come back and ask both of you and Dr. Deborah Sieger some questions, but I want to get to Michelle Dech because people need to know what she does. Michelle Dech is executive director of the LGBT Center of Greater Reading, which is a very important organization which offers support and advice for people who are gay or transgender. Michelle, tell us about what you do and what services are there for people who are afraid to come out or who need support. Thank you again for what you do, and please share with us what you do professionally for people who are gay or transgender.
Sure. Thank you for having me, Dr. Amprey, and I'm thrilled to be here with Dr. Sieger and Caroline. Your words are just exceptional today. I can't top those in any way. Everybody's journey is a little bit different, and you guys really spoke to the heart, so thank you for sharing that with us. So as Dr. Amprey said, I'm the executive director of the LGBT Center of Greater Reading. We are a 501c3 organization located in the Nativity Lutheran Church on 13th Street in Reading, just a couple blocks down the street from BCTV and Albright College. We provide support services to the LGBT community. And some of those support services include support groups. Right now, I believe we've got a total of 9 that are running that are led by professionals. They're all education-based. And the facilitators that do that are all volunteer for us. So that's one of the services. We just expanded, as Dr. Sieger was talking about in the newspaper, the article, and we expanded to provide counseling services. And I will tell you, through this pandemic and even before the pandemic, you know, the LGBT community in general, there's so much work to do here for the community. There's so many people who need a safe place, who need a home, right? We're all about solutions, and I've literally had this like one track mind lately of solutions. Here's a problem we've identified, an issue, a disparity. What can we do to fix that? And so we've been moving pretty quickly. So I love it. I'm very blessed to do it every day. So we did expand, and we are now providing counseling services to the community. And in that addition and to our services and portfolio, we needed more space here at the center. And so the church that we rent from, they have just been phenomenal. I want to give the shout out to Nativity Lutheran. They've really been very supportive. And although I will tell you, when they see me coming lately, I think they're thinking, oh my gosh, what's she going to want now? I went 2 weeks ago to them and said, listen, I need some more space. What can we do? We have to get this done. So we chatted about a few things, and we came up with another room that would be available for us. And I will tell you, they said to me, when do you want this to happen? And my answer was yesterday. So that same weekend, we worked the entire weekend here and relocated some things and moved offices and whatnot. And so we were able to now have a counseling suite that we provide the space for. And that also gave us an opportunity to rent some more space where we have a kitchen area, which includes a food pantry. So we're going to be expanding food drive and expanding that pantry to be able to serve the public as well. Besides the counseling and support groups, we also provide professional development training. We go out to social service agencies, civic organizations, businesses, schools, healthcare professionals, and we do training. Anything from LGBT 101 to a more in-depth look at our transgender friends and family. So that keeps us pretty busy. We also provide resources and referrals. We now partner with more than, I think we're up to like 68 partners throughout Berks County and beyond. So we do a lot of referral services. And we provide some advocacy on a personal level and an issue-based level. We recently partnered with the Reading Metro Cab Company. You know, that was one of the things that we learned, especially through the pandemic. And we knew this beforehand, but it really became even more prevalent during the pandemic. When you are providing services, it's great to be able to do that, but it's really important to be able to get the people to you. And so a lot of our community, you know, there's disparities and there's access barriers to access to even get here. So we reached out and made a contract with Reading Metro Cab so that we now can, you know, anybody that needs to come to the center, wants to come to the center, go home from the center, we will pick up that tab. They just have to specifically mention the account from the LGBT center. We have a clothing closet on site, a toiletry closet, all free for anybody in need. We do a few things on a monthly basis that are program oriented. We do have a senior lunch that's been on ice right now simply because of COVID. Quite honestly, you know, when COVID hit in middle of March, we shut down like everybody else, and we were trying to pivot everything over to a virtual platform. And we were able to do that pretty quickly. But I, like Dr. Sieger, you know, this whole technology thing is there's a lot to learn, and I'm learning something every day about it. But anyway, we were able to pivot and offer the same programs and services virtually for quite some time. And what I discovered through that was, it was probably about maybe 2 months ago now, I popped in on one of our youth groups that meets, and because I hadn't seen them for a while. And so I popped in on the group meeting and just to check in with them. And I put it out there to them and I said, listen, you know, I'm really thinking about bringing you guys back on site for one day a week, because we were meeting twice a week. And I wasn't sure what I was going to get back, honestly, you know, and I said, I just want to throw it out there. Are you guys interested in that? Are you willing? I mean, there's going to be some strict rules we have to follow with, you know, protocol for COVID. And they didn't even let me finish my spiel. And they were, oh my gosh, yes, we want to come back. Yes, yes, please, please. So We started them about 2 months ago. We brought them back one day a week. And that quickly led to, we want to come back the other day too. So we've got the kids back on site meeting twice a week now. And our 50 plus group, which I am actually a part of, we've started meeting here as well again once a month. So some of those programs that we were doing virtually, we are now pivoting slowly and very cautiously back on site. So we're really happy about that. We've got a book club that runs monthly that we just started not too long ago. We usually have a monthly game night. That's another thing that's kind of on hold at the moment. And we do a networking event once a month on the third Thursday of every month. It's called Third Thirsty Thursday. It's a networking event. We usually meet somewhere out at a restaurant, and the last real solid meeting that we had was in February, and we had 93 people attend just for that event over at Sly Fox in West Reading. And so of course that was put on ice, but we had the opportunity just last month to come down to the Franklin Station downtown in Reading and Saucony Creek. They have a really enormous patio out back. And they said to us, listen, would you consider coming and doing it socially distanced? Everybody needs to stay at their tables, but at least you can physically see somebody in person. And you know, so we did that. We did it last month. We're doing it this month. It's the 15th of this month at the same place. So we're really excited to be able to do some of that stuff again. And I guess lastly, I just want to say, you know, we do some other events throughout the year, and we are moving forward with a couple of them. We are having a fall harvest event on the 24th of October. We recently partnered with the Olivet's Boy and Girls Club to do movie nights. We were trying to get creative and how can we continue to serve the youth in our community. And so we purchased a 24-foot inflatable outdoor movie screen. It's enormous. And now we take it with us. And so the Olivet Club, we're setting up different locations with them, and we're showing movies and bringing the kids in outside and showing movies for them. So yes, things have been busy. There's always something to do. There's always more to do. And we are going to keep right on evolving and changing to meet the needs of the of our community. Absolutely.
Michelle, please give us a phone number that people can call if they want to seek your help from you.
Sure, absolutely. So our number is 610-864-5800. All of our events and our support groups and pretty much everything we do is on Facebook, our Facebook events page. We also have a website that is www.lgbtcenterofreading.com.
You probably can't answer this question. We'll try anyway. Caroline lives in Virginia. Do you have any contacts? Any organizations that you would know about that do the same thing in Virginia? I should have asked you that before today. You probably don't. But if you do, tell us. You have any contacts at all out of state? Probably not.
I'm muted. Sorry.
I was asking Michelle that question.
Oh, I'm sorry. I thought you were asking Caroline too. Yeah. Actually, I do have a contact in Richmond, Virginia, but off the top of my head, I cannot remember what the specific name of the organization is, but there is, Caroline. So I can actually send that to you if you don't have it. They are located in Richmond.
Okay.
We actually, you know, and I have to say, I've been really proud of the progress that's been made in Virginia in the 6 years that I've been gone, having been in Pennsylvania for six and now back. Most major cities have an LGBTQ center, have an active queer community. I live in they call themselves a city. Maybe not. It's a very small city if it's a city, but they have a very active LGBTQ center that is active in the community, having a pride event. And so that's in Stanton. Stanton City has one of their own. And I'm sure they have one here in Harrisonburg near James Madison University. And I know that there's one in Charlottesville. So, you know, I think that it's important to, you know, get on the Google machine and see what is local to you. You might be surprised to find that your city has something, and something is better than nothing.
I have a question for you, Caroline. You're an athlete, roller derby. Mm-hmm. I used to love to watch when I was younger. And I guess the stereotype we have is that women athletes are stronger, more robust. And that's probably an unfortunate stereotype. Would you say that because they are athletes, that they can be more supportive and back you up when you run into difficulty? Or is that a wrong assumption on my part?
I think it's less about being an athlete and more about being a community. Uh-huh. I mean, certainly the people I play roller derby with are incredibly physically strong. They work really hard to be the best athletes that they can be. But I think that I depend on them more as for the strength of community that they have and to know that I have that kind of support. I think that, you know, being 35 and not... and having grown up in the time that I did, it was very rare that I feared for my physical safety for being a member of the LGBTQ community. But, you know, I have had altercations at bars where men assume I'm something that I'm not and are aggressive with their intentions. And I have been lucky enough to be out with a group of incredibly strong women who are there to back me up and make sure that nothing happens to me. But I think that it comes back down to community more than actual, like, these are strong athletic women. You know, I think that people find that wherever they find their tribe and their people. Like, I know people who are part of regional theater communities, and they find strength with being part of that community, with the pride communities in various small towns and subcultures. I think that finding your community is really important, and there's community out there for everyone, believe it or not. Everyone, there's so many different groups, even in especially in the age of COVID, where so many people are finding ways to make themselves more accessible, even when they have to be distanced. Like, if you like Dungeons and Dragons, you can play that online, I'm sure. I know people do that. If you're interested in sports, there are people talking about it and talk about ways to make it more accessible. I think that something that's happened during COVID that has kind of woken us all up is that we're really seeing where our diversity is and how far it needs to be pushed in our communities, especially with what's happening in the wake of George Floyd and Breonna Taylor. You know, we're seeing that we need to push ourselves. We need to be out of our comfort zones. And that includes the LGBTQ community. We need to be pushing to offer acceptance to more people across the board. I've been very lucky to walk through the world as someone who doesn't look threatening and doesn't look like, honestly, most of the time, a gay person. I have a lot of privilege that I walk through the world with. And it's up to me, in light of that privilege, with the strength of my community behind me, to be strong for people who are potentially more visible targets than I am.
Thank you. I think it's so important to have people who are positive as role models. A couple other questions. You've had, in terms of your job searches, mm-hmm. Is there anything you would have recommended to someone who is gay, who's looking to get employed? Is there anything they should avoid or do, or is there anything you run into more difficulty with?
Well, I mean, part of it is doing your research on the companies you're applying to.
Uh-huh.
Part of it is giving them a good hard look before you step in the door for that first interview, and to really try to understand as much as you can before you're in the door what the culture might look like and what the beliefs of the people who own the company look like and what area of town are they in. You know, do drive by. Do they have political signs on their front lawn? Like, I did research on the companies that I applied to. And then when I was in the door, my eyes were very open to the people who were walking around that company and how they greeted me, how I felt welcomed or not welcomed. And then when it got to the point where I was having a serious interview with a serious job offer, I was very clear about who I am and what I will and will not tolerate. You know, I'm not going to put up with homophobia. I'm not going to put up with racism. When I'm hiring, I'm not going to hire the same people that have always been hired necessarily, because our hiring pool is a lot more diverse than it used to be. And I'm not here to make people comfortable. I'm here to put out the best product that I can. And I'm here to make my workspace a community as well. And I've been very clear about that with the people I'm working with, because we have hired some people who don't look like most of the people who work there already. And that's a good thing.
Well said. Deb talked about cloning Ruth Bader Ginsburg. I wish we could clone you also. but thank you. I think that was well said. I think that was good advice, solid advice that I would not have thought of in terms of offering advice to people who are gay.
That's right.
I probably could talk to you for hours, Deb, but I know that you haven't been the president of the National Organization of Women for Pennsylvania, and your strong stance for people at Kutztown. Any advice you want to offer people who are trepidatious or frightened about coming out, or I think that some of your experiences will really be helpful for some of them, if you would, please.
I so appreciated Caroline's comments. Thank you. Very informative and well thought out and deliberate. And I wanted to say one more thing about athletes, not just athletes, but I do think that there is personal development and belief in oneself through athletics that when you have a team that helps you be a person in a community, that in itself is strengthening regardless of the size of your bicep. You may be really lousy at hitting the basket. I was the best seat warmer in the whole basketball court all through junior and senior high school. I had that bench just about as warm as it could be. I couldn't hit the basket worth love nor money. And I never understood in those days why you had to stop at half court. Can you believe that, Caroline? There was a time when you played girls basketball, you had to stop at half court. You couldn't put your foot on the other side. How's that for discriminatory?
Well, when I was growing up playing ice hockey, girls weren't allowed to hit.
Really?
I grew up in north of Boston, and I played girls ice hockey. And
we never heard of girls playing ice hockey. I'm so glad you did that, at least. That is amazing. Hey, you weren't that old. You know, when I first came to the university, there, again, was no protection. I didn't have tenure. I was a loudmouth. I got introduced the first day in front of the entire faculty as somebody who'd just come back from volunteering. I'd quit my job, my paid job, to be a volunteer for the Equal Rights Amendment. Well, that's all. Then I was a branded person, right? Here's this woman, you know, who clearly is, you know, big shoulders and a strong body and a big mouth. And she was the president of NOW, and she went away for, you know, didn't have a job and went away for the ERA. And I knew that was going to be, that was a defining moment when I got introduced that way to the whole faculty at the breakfast. And so I kind of backed off a little bit. I didn't run into the closet, but I was much more cautious, as Caroline described, not even out of fear, but out of how to be an effective member of that university community. What could I do to get the most out of the very fortunate position? Because I was in a tenure track position. And I think that the piece that Caroline talked about is that you keep doing what you know you're good at as best you can, and people begin to recognize that. When we first moved here, there were two 80-something-year-olds next door on the farm, so Dutch that when Wayne opened his mouth and said a sentence the first time I met him, I didn't understand him, and I flunked French 1 twice, so like I didn't get Pennsylvania Dutch at all. And I put it in context, and I kind of waited a minute, and then I put it together what he had just said with his Dutchy accent. And the reason that they came to love us as their own children, two adult women, they called us the girls. We were in our 40s. They called us the girls. And I said, you can call me anything you want, Wayne. I just love this old Dutchy guy. And they loved us. And it wasn't maybe 2 years until we were at an auction together, standing in a cornfield, you know, bidding on an old corn wagon. And he looked at his wife and he said, you know, these girls work really hard. And that was so enlightening to me, because he cared about our work ethic so much more. And he didn't even know the words to use to describe us. Lesbian was probably never part of his vocabulary. And I guess I think there are cautions that we need to take, but I think that anybody taking a new job has to be a little cautious too. I don't think that's something that lesbians and gays and trans people get, you know, really isolated about. And the other thing you can do is what Caroline was talking about was, you can also ask about the benefit package. And that brings up in a safe place at the interview, you're going to find out whether you want to work with these folks or whether you got a real bigot across the table when you ask what the benefits are if you're legally married. And if that's a piece of sandpaper, rub it against a piece of sandpaper, you just go get your coat and go home. And somehow you'll find a place that fits for you. And so I think that the beauty of having something like a brandy new spiffy LGBT center is that there is a place for somebody who is willing to take that first step and put their hand on the doorknob and walk in. You gotta believe that that's a safe place, because it is. And you also have to learn that there are hidden resources that you might never, ever think about. The fellow who was the Lutheran pastor at the chaplain at the university was one of the strongest proponents of starting an LGBT center for years before we ever had one at Kutztown. And when I was doing work with the statewide, it was called Spark then, the Statewide Pennsylvania Rights Coalition, I found out from my coworker who became the chair, actually, of the Pennsylvania Human Relations Commission, Steve Glassman, who's still a bosom buddy friend of mine. He was out beating the bushes in Pennsylvania for getting the Human Relations Commission Act amended to include LGBT trans people. And we were running up against the same Republicans who are there now, who were conservative. They didn't want to see us. And so he started out in the community. He started going to places where he knew there were little pockets. But one of the things he found that he said, even he, who was a consummate community organizer, you're not going to believe who I found is in support of this. I said, who? The Pennsylvania Sheriff's Association. Wow. I said, Steve, are you out of your brains? What do you mean? He said, I'm not kidding you. I talked to the president of the, I said, how did that happen? He said, he's tired of lesbian and gay people having the shit kicked out of them on Saturday night at the bar when it closes, and he has no way to arrest the perpetrators. And I said, you gotta be kidding, man. He said, no, they're ready to sign on. He didn't even have to ask the association. He said, we're ready to go. Now, who would have ever thunk it? How could you ever think the Pennsylvania Sheriff's Association would be in a major leader in saying we need some protections for these people because we can't do our job protecting all people, and that's our job? Can you imagine? So, you know, I mean, we have to hear stories like that to realize there are hidden pockets, like my 92-year-old next-door neighbor who called me girl. Now, I'm the president of Pennsylvania National Organization for Women. Nobody calls me a girl except that 92-year-old honey who I, you know, have to translate as Dutch in my head before I can answer him. What an ally. They love the girls next door. And so the Pennsylvania Sheriff's Association. And so I say that kind of stuff, not arrogantly, not boastfully, with great humility, that we have to sometimes get to know each other, and we have to risk as much. One of the things we used to make our social work majors do was join a club that was about as far away from their comfort zone as they could find. And a lot of them were good Christian, often Protestant, white females. And we'd say, where are you going to go to the club that you want to learn to, you know, go to for a month or two to get to know some of those people? It was one of the most frightening things they ever did. And yet they formed bonds with those kids. The straight ones went to the LGBT center. The men went to the women's center. The white kids went to the black center. The black kids went to whatever was white on campus, which was just about everything. And that's the way progress gets made. And those groups on campus began to really get to know each other. And then you would find the young Dems and the young Republicans working together with the LGBT center because they had friends there. And so we have to learn to risk a little bit. And the LGBT center is a place like that where you can learn to risk. So that's what I would say to the kids that, and young people or old people. We're just as bad. There are a lot of older gay men who have been subjected to some of the worst bullying, harassment, and physical violence that this world can perpetrate without a gun, let me tell you. And so it's in all of us. If you want to grow, if you want to be in a different place, there are places where you can do that. And you never know where those little candles are.
Some of the most ardent homophobes are devout Christians. And my response to them usually is that I didn't choose to be born straight. Gays didn't choose to be born gay. And I can't believe a God who loves all people would condemn someone who came into the world without a choice, make this kind of decision. I have to remind them over and over again that we don't choose our sexuality. It's given to us. And that I believe that God loves all people of all genders, all races, all preferences.
Joe, God don't make no junk.
Amen. Amen. Michelle, I want you to give your number again because there are people who need help, who need to know. What's your number again, one more time, please?
Sure. It's 610-864-5800.
Ladies, I want to thank you. I didn't think we'd put these up in an hour, but we have. I'm most appreciative of your presence. I want to remind our viewers that you'll see a visual on the screen. This will tell you how you can contact me, because I think that what we talk about here for this show should always be what's important to you in the community. Feel free to call, email me about what you think we should be doing. Again, I want to thank Michelle Deck for what she brings with the LGBT Center of Greater Reading. I want to thank Dr. Deborah Sieger, Professor Emeritus of Kutztown University. I want to thank Caroline Cook, who's the MD director of a manufacturing company in Starnesville, Virginia. Thank you, ladies. Thank you, what you stand for, what you do. God bless. Good night, everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Great to know you.